Oh, really? I was almost sad I was going to be because I'm trying to get a big one.
Okay. Welcome to the. I'll be giving four lectures on expanders and extractors. So I'm going to survey this area, just do basic things, roughly two lectures on each. But let me give you an overview of some of the things we'll discuss. So, an expander is roughly defined as a graph where every set of nodes has many neighbors. And this is useful in computer science. There are many applications. I won't focus on applications, except, well, let me give you an example of why this might be useful in computer science. You might want to design a network using an expander graph, because if you don't have an expander graph, that means there's some sort of bottleneck here, right? If you want to send packets from S to elsewhere, they'll have trouble getting past this bottleneck if it's not an expander. So expander graphs are useful for networks. They're also useful for constructing pseudorandom generators and for constructing extractors. So we'll discuss that. So what are extractors? At a high level, these are randomness extractors or just extractors. So here the idea is you have a weak random source. And what I mean is this is a defective source of randomness. We'll define it more carefully soon. But what you'd like to do is feed it into, you'd like to purify this source. So you'd feed it into an extractor, and the output is close to uniform. So this is sort of the dream. Like many good things in life, it's impossible. If you wanted this for a general weak random source, it's impossible. So there are three ways around. There are three ways to circumvent it, which give rise to three different notions of extractors. So one thing you can do are called seeded extractors, where you add just a little bit of high quality randomness. The second thing, you could do multi-source extractors. Where you have two or more independent sources of randomness, two or more independent weak sources of randomness. And the third thing you could do is, we'll call them seedless extractors for structured sources. So here we give up on the notion of having this be a fully general source of randomness, and we impose some conditions on it. So we'll discuss what this means. The seeded extractors have had the most applications. So these also have many applications in computer science, including to constructing types of expander graphs and also to constructing pseudorandom generators. So we'll see some connections between these. Some more on an overview. You could, will hopefully make more sense later, but we'll look at seeded, multi-source, let's say two-source or multi-source, seedless. One of the nice things about both of these objects is that there are different ways to view them. So for expanders, there's a combinatorial way, so here it's basically the definition. And there's also an algebraic, well, let me write first a probabilistic way, and there's an algebraic way. So the definition we'll use is combinatorial, but there's a sort of a more or less equivalent way of looking at it in terms of the second largest eigenvalue. And there's also a probabilistic way of looking at it as random walks on graphs. I should say rapidly mixing. For extractors, here the definitions are going to be probabilistic, but they'll have some nice combinatorial interpretations. We'll see that the seeded extractors have some relation to expanders. I'll put it in quotes, it's not exactly. For two source extractors, they're going to have bear a connection to Ramsey graphs. Well, there are different variations of seedless extractors. It's not clear here. And actually, here for algebraic, we don't have such good algebraic methods for these methods. We do know that lambda 2 is insufficient. We don't really have such good definitions here. Okay, so. But anyway, we'll be touching on these different subjects. So let me start with, let me see if there's, oh, I should have said pseudorandom, you know. So these are interesting from a pseudorandomist perspective in two different ways. One, they're interesting pseudorandom objects on their own. So random graphs, or functions are expanders or extractors with high probability. So constructing them explicitly is much more challenging and very interesting. And secondly, both expanders and extractors are useful tools in constructing pseudorandom generators for other purposes, but I think they're fascinating in their own right. So let's define things. So I'm going to focus on expanders today. So we can mention there are two different types of expansion. Also, I said you can measure the number of vertices adjacent to a set, or you could measure the number of edges going out of a set. So these are vertex and edge expansion. So the vertex expansion, we'll call it HV. We'll take the worst case subset. Okay, so I should say we have a graph of edges and nodes, and I'll always assume that there are n nodes. And let me just talk about deregular graphs. So we'll take the worst case subset of nodes of size at most n over 2. Whoa, I have to be careful. So we don't expect, if the size of the subset is, say, n minus 1, there's not much room to expand. So we have to say it's at most n over 2. We'll look at the number of neighbors. Gamma of S is the neighbors, excluding the set itself, divided by the set. So the fraction of neighbors of S that don't lie in S itself. And the edge expansion. Will be similar. So here we have the minimum. This time we'll measure the number of edges. So David used this notation. This is the number of edges between a set S and its complement divided by the size of S. And I'll say that computing expansion is NP-hard. Either one of these. So we don't expect to do it exactly, but we can hope to approximate it or get some sense about it. But it makes explicit constructions more challenging. So let's look at some examples first.
So David, in the first definition, you do, so H of V is at most 2, the way you define it, so you don't limit like to N over D or something?
Yeah, let's say it's at most 2. There are other definitions, but...
Well, it seems natural to do it to size N over D so that it can be upper bounded by D by the degree, but... Okay.
Yeah, let's stick with this for now. You could do N over D. So I realized I had something that's wrong. Let's not worry. So let's just start with some simple examples. We'll look at the vertex expansion and edge expansion of some simple graphs just to get a sense. So cycle. Here it's, some constant times 1 over n, right? There's a set of, if you just take n over 2, if you take a semi-circle, that's going to be a worst case set. And similarly for edge expansion. Well, let me say first that the relationship between these two, of course, the edge expansion is always at least the vertex expansion, and this is always at most d times the vertex expansion. So a lot of times we'll be looking at constant degree graphs, so we won't really care too much whether it's vertex or edge expansion. You could look at something like the 2D grid or torus, and here it's going to be 1 over root n. Here, you could, if you have a 2D grid, for example, a cut like that is going to have a boundary, which is 1 over root n times its size. And that's going to be the worst case. You can look at, more interesting maybe is the hypercube. Here the edge expansion is a constant. I think it's just 1. This corresponds to a subcube, is the worst case. And this is going to be 1 over square root log n. Here, the worst case is you can view, if you think of the hypercube, as sets of different sizes, the worst case is just sets of size at most 1 over 2. I'm going to spend a lot of time discussing the use of the second eigenvalue and random walks. But before I do that, let me just show you a combinatorial lemma that's interesting. So how do we know that really? I asserted that this is a worst case bound, but but in fact, there's a general theorem that says that in any vertex transitive graph, any very symmetric graph, the vertex expansion is at least 1 over the diameter. So let me show you that because it's not hard and it. vertex transitive. The vertex expansion is at least 1 over the diameter. So the vertex expansion is always at least 1 over the diameter, and you'll notice it's tight in these examples.
How it was the square root?
So the diameter, maybe I should say the diameter of a graph, right? The diameter of the graph is the maximum over VW. The distance from V to W. So the diameter of the cycle is N over 2. And the diameter of a greater torus is some constant times root N. So the torus is vertex transitive. So vertex transitive, of course, means that for any two nodes, there's an automorphism of the graph mapping one node to the other node. And an automorphism is a permutation of the nodes that preserves edges and non-edges. So how do we prove this? So let me just sketch it here. So the idea is we'll pick two nodes uniformly at random from the node set, and we'll consider, and we'll pick a random shortest path P from V to W. Well, it's undirected. We're only dealing with undirected graphs, so it's between V and W. And we're going to So since it's vertex transitive for any node U, the probability that this node U is in this path is at most the expected, it equals the expected length of the path divided by the number of nodes. So let me call this, so this is L over N. So L will be the expected length, where L is in most of the diameter.
The probability that U is in the path, like, if you're picking there's one shortest path, and like vertices are either in the path we're not in the past, so I don't understand, like, how can you assign a probability? Wouldn't it either be 1 or 0?
We're picking the starting and end nodes. I should have said, I should add a plus 1 here, though, because a path of length L has L plus 1 nodes. And let me denote... boundary of S to be S. So now we're going to bound that the probability that that P contains a node in the boundary in two different ways. So on the one hand, on the one hand, this is at most L times, just by the union bound applying here. I keep doing L instead of L plus 1.
Did you fix S?
Sorry?
Did you fix S?
Oh, good point. Sorry about that. Yeah, so fix S. Thank you. right, over n. And on the other hand, this probability is at least, well, it's at least the probability that V and W land on opposite sides of the cut. And if they land on opposite sides of the cut, then the path between them has to cross the cut. So the probability that V is in S and W is not in S, or vice versa, so this is equal to twice the density of S. So here I'm using, right, so here mu of S, size of S over n. And now we get the result just by, it follows just by comparing these. So maybe I should have written that out. Well, this is actually equal to this one. So now we get, mu of delta S. And mu of S bar is at least a half. So this is at least. And so this is equivalent to the definition of expansion. Okay, so very symmetric graphs have expansion at least 1 over the diameter. But this is not exactly what we're going to go for here. What's interesting is that random graphs have. Let me fix. So we'll let's fix d to be a constant. So random graphs have expansion bounded below by some absolute constant.
By random graphs, you mean Erdős-Rényi generation?
Yeah, I mean, except here we have deregular, so I'm thinking of, since we want it to be a deregular graph, we'll choose it uniformly at random from among all deregular graphs on n nodes. And then can we construct them? So this is really our focus. I'll just tell you, there are several elegant constructions that I won't have time to really to prove them, but let me state a couple of them.
Is 1 over d omega 1, for example? Because you fixed d as well.
Yeah, okay, that's...
it's actually going to improve with d.
Yeah, so it's...
So this is a high probability.
Right, yeah.
Yeah,
with high probability. Right, so...
You can pick d, it'll be 3, for example.
Right, so random... So random 3 regular graphs. But it will improve with d, so if... So actually, a random deregular graph, but this goes back to the definition, as Yevgeny pointed out, you know, by having n over 2 here. You know, if you want to put something like n over d here, you can get expansion close to d, really.
But then you could have an expander that's not even connected.
So
n over 2 at least implies.
Yes, it's connected. Right, that's a good point, yeah. Okay, thanks. Any other questions or corrections, comments? Okay, so let me state... Um, So the following graph is a three regular expander, but we'll let the nodes be correspond to the, we'll take the nodes to be a prime field, and then we'll connect a node x to x plus 1, x minus 1, and negative x inverse, where we'll just call 0 inverse 0. So this is so this is a three regular graph. Well, I mean, it has a self-loop at 0, but that's no big deal. It's a three regular graph, and it has constant expansion. But the proof is, at least the one that we know now, is quite deep. It involves Selberg's 3/16th theorem, which is quite difficult, I'm told. So another nice example. Also, although this seems really explicit, I mean, how much more explicit can you ask for? There's one thing that's not ideal if you think of computation, and that's that we don't know how to find a large prime efficiently. Right now, it's a big open problem to find an n-bit prime in time polynomial in n. So this is explicit, but we'll think of this as sort of weakly explicit, in the sense we can construct this in time. We construct this in time polynomial in say the size of the graph, which seems like what you'd want, but you can hope for something better, which is useful for many applications, namely that you can, we'll say, strongly explicit. So here we think of the number of nodes as being exponential. So the description of all the nodes is polynomial, and given the description of a node, you can determine the description of all its neighbors in polynomial time. Okay, so a given node. So in other words, given a node V, can determine its neighbors in time polynomial in the logarithm of the size of the graph. So this is strongly explicit, and that's useful for many applications. But you know, this is only strongly explicit if we can find the prime efficiently, which we can under Kramer's conjecture about the gaps between primes being log squared prime, but we don't know that in general. So there's another construction, say, by Gaber and Galil. I think Margulis constructed this, and they proved it, or some. Right. Let me just write Margulis. And here the nodes are ZM cross ZM. So the additive group mod M cross itself, and
it's less randomness than constructing the whole graph randomly.
Right. I mean, yeah, so it depends what the application is. Sometimes it might be okay to do that. Right, it's not that much randomness. But sometimes we want to avoid randomness altogether. Right, and here are the neighbors of a node XY. So now a node corresponds to an ordered pair. And there are eight neighbors. Let me just write it kind of succinctly. this corresponds to four neighbors, x plus y plus 0, x plus y plus 1, x minus y plus 0, x minus y plus 1. And I think that's what it is. Okay, so this is a very clean construction, and now we could take M to be anything. So this is a strongly explicit construction.
So is there any intuition why the
why this? Yeah, so
either that one or this one.
Well, this is a cycle, right? So this is starting from a cycle, and it's adding in one more permutation, and it's saying, my only intuition would be just that it's, you know, the cycle is with the additive group, and here we're, the inverse is a multiplicative group, and somehow this is saying something about the difference in the additive and multiplicative groups. But I don't know, maybe someone else has. Oh, this corresponds to, so the degree here is 8. So I'm thinking of, right, so this corresponds to 8 elements.
I was going to say, possible in your response to the question that was just asked is that, like, really, if you think about it, it's technically very easy to construct expanders because most graphs are expanders. The only hard part is proving something is an expander. So if you just wrote down any operations you wanted to form a graph, it would probably generate expanders, but then you'd have to prove it. So I guess maybe that might help.
I mean, just because, I mean, it's true, right, most things may work, but I mean, it doesn't mean that most things that you write down will work.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
So, right, for all we know, right, everything that's sort of easy to write down doesn't work.
Sure, most things I wrote down would not work.
Right, Daniel.
Just to be clear, that graph you have written down there is directed?
No, it's right. Oh, yeah, so maybe, that's a good question. Maybe I misremember. Right, there's the plus or minus. Maybe you have to.
If it's plus and minus, then it would be undirected if it goes to show.
So I don't remember exactly, sorry. It's something like this. I mean, you could look up the exact form. I apologize. But it's something very simple, and maybe M has to be of a certain form. No, I guess this is undirected, right? Because we're always, I think this form's, okay, the exact form isn't crucial, it's just, the main point is just that there's some simple description that you can write down. I think I wrote down the right thing. If there's some mistake, it's very similar. Okay, so now I want to talk about, okay, any questions before? So now I want to talk a bit about the role of the second eigenvalue. So David talked about this before. So the expander mixing lemma says that if the second eigenvalue is small, then the number of edges between two sets is what you expect, more or less. So let's look at that. I'll write a plus sign just because I'll write something slightly stronger that can be useful sometimes. So, which is just that if we have two sets, the number of edges between S and T minus the number that we expect. So how many do we expect? Well, there are S times T edge slots, and we expect each one of them to be filled with probability D over N. And then this should be at most lambda ST. There's another term. I mean, it's typically small, but it can be useful. For a small S and T, these terms are quite small. But the reason this can be useful is if you take S equal to T, T equal to S complement. Right, then it says, then this talks about what we're interested in, the number of edges between S and its complement, minus what you expect. And I forgot to say little s is the size of S, little t is the size of T. Right, so D over N. So then this is at most lambda. And now things cancel out, and we could just get S.
I mean, is that inequality the same thing as the top inequality in the special case? Is it like after you do the arithmetic?
Right. So all I'm doing is just right, because now the t is n minus s, so now we get duplicate terms. So now we just get this. So now we see that. So we get that the number of edges from s to s bar, right, is at least d minus lambda. S times n minus s. Okay, so it's nice that it gives us a lower bound on the number of edges between S and S bar. So, and this is, right, and if S is at most 2, this is always at least. So here I'm thinking if little s is at most n over 2. So it tells us that the edge expansion is at least d minus lambda over 2 times the size of s. But now I'm puzzled because if s is n over 2, it's just the number of edges. So, yeah, okay. So it's fine. Sorry.
We know in this case lambda has to be between 0 and d. I just want to make sure that the second leg.
Right. So, and I forgot to say also. So, I'm using the same notation as David used. So here we have eigenvalues d. The largest eigenvalue in a d regular graph is d. This is at least lambda 2. And if the graph is connected, lambda 1 is strictly bigger than lambda 2. And of course, as David mentioned, if the graph is bipartite, if and only if the smallest eigenvalue is negative d. And lambda here is the maximum of lambda 2 and negative lambda n. Although actually for this bound, I think you just need lambda 2. So what this says is that the edge expansion, so the point here, let me just, in this box here, I'll just say that the edge expansion is at least d minus lambda over 2. So using this slightly stronger version of the expander mixing lemma. But I want to prove the expander mixing lemma since it's very useful. It came up in two talks already. It's not hard to prove either. So the starting idea of this is just how to write this down. I forgot to say what these are, the eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix. Okay, so we're denoting A, the adjacency matrix of the graph, which David defined, and you probably all know. So we just want to write this down in a linear algebraic way. What we can do is just write the indicator vector corresponding to the set S. Let's say transpose A. So here, the indicator vector of S has ones. It has ones corresponding to the set S and zeros elsewhere. And so the idea is, well, let's just the eigenvalue D. So A has eigenvalue D corresponding to the eigenvector of all ones. That's where the eigenvalue D comes from. So we just want to break this up so the idea is just to break up the vectors 1s and 1t into two components. One some multiple of the all ones vector, and the other orthogonal to it. So let me call this just the one vector. So and so 1s is just s over n times 1 plus some vector, let's call it vs, where vs is orthogonal to the all ones vector. And similarly for t. So now let's just apply this and see what we get. So est equals s over n 1 plus vs transpose a t over n 1. And okay, so let's now we're going to get four terms, and two of them are going to be zero. So let's see. So one term is st over n squared times 1 transpose a 1. Okay, that's not zero, but we know exactly what this is. A times 1 is just, this is just D times the all ones vector. And 1 transpose 1 is N. So we get, so this term is just D ST over N. Now let's look at the other term. There's this S over N 1 transpose A. T plus T over N 1. T over N VS transpose A 1 plus VS transpose A. Okay, and now the point is, I claim that this is zero because A times 1 is just a multiple of the all ones vector, and VS is orthogonal to the all ones vector. So this term is zero. And similarly, this term is zero. And so we're only left with this term. And this term corresponds to this expression here. So EST minus DST over again. It's the most absolute value of the and so this is in most lambda times the L2 times the L2 norm. And this we know exactly what the L2 norm of this is because of the definition. Right, so what this is saying is we have this vector 1 sub s, and we broke it into two components. We broke it into some multiple of the all ones vector and vs. And these are orthogonal. So just by the Pythagorean theorem, we know the norm of v sub s. So I won't finish calculating it, but it's, I mean, well, I'll, right, so that this is, well, I'll just say, yeah, it's exactly what we wanted, s n minus s. And we're done. So it's not hard. Any questions about that?
So in the second line, it shouldn't be the largest eigenvalue that comes in?
Oh, I forgot to say, right, that the, right, so A has, so A, the point is that these vectors V are orthogonal to the all ones vector. So A, when you multiply by A, by Vs, right, the L2 norm, this is at most lambda times Vs. This is, so Vs is you could write it as a linear combination of eigenvectors, but there's zero component placed on the all ones vector. So so all of those eigenvalues are at most lambda. Other questions?
Why does this immediately say
we mix well with it? Oh, well, it gives the bound EST minus DST over N is at most this, which is the same expression that I wrote here.
Okay, just as far as random walks go.
Right, we didn't do random walks, so that's the next thing I'm going to do. Unless there aren't. Okay. Make sure.
I kind of could just be like, why is it called a mixing lemma? Because it sounds a little off, because doesn't you yet talk about mixing when you think about it?
Well, it's not okay, right? So it's not mixing for random walk, but it says that the edges are mixed up. I think that's the way I interpret it. I don't know. Okay, so maybe, now the question is, how small can the second eigenvalue be, right? So if we can get a really tiny second eigenvalue, then we get a better mixing. So how small can the second eigenvalue be? So there's, Alon and Bapana showed that second eigenvalue is always at least 2 square root d minus 1 minus little o of 1. So if you think of a sequence of graphs, of d regular graphs, as n gets large, it's at least 2 square root d minus 1 minus little o of one term. But it's actually easy to prove there's an easier proposition that's just that lambda is always at least square root d minus d. And this we get to see this. The idea is to look at the trace of a squared in two different ways. So on the one hand, when you compute a squared, this is going to be d times n. So we're at the other side. A squared itself is a diagonal matrix with d's on the diagonal. But of course, this is also equal to the sum of the eigenvalues squared. And we know that the largest eigenvalue is d, and all the other eigenvalues are at most lambda. And that's it, right? So just bringing this, we get dn minus d squared square root, which is the same. So that's the proof of.
Yeah? Why do we know dn is equal to the trace of a squared? Because.
A squared, if you look at a squared, it has d's on the diagonal. Right, so they correspond, think of it as paths of length 2 that get back to.
Oh, yeah.
To the same vertex.
Does this lambda match the lambda for Gen P?
I'm sorry?
What is the lambda of Gen P? What is the lambda of
lambda? What is the lambda of, right, so right, so for a random graph, it's known to be close to this bound, but right, so Friedman showed. With high probability, lambda is at most 2 square root d minus 1 plus some small term. But the Alone-Bapana theorem motivated people to, they defined a Ramanujan graph as a graph with lambda at most 2 square root d minus 1. Well, they also had bipartite Ramanujan graphs where if you exclude the d and minus d eigenvalues, they're also at most 2 square root d minus 1. And famously, Margulis and Lubotsky, Philip Cernak constructed explicit. They have explicit, in fact, strongly explicit, I think, strongly explicit Ramanujan graphs. So we know strongly explicit Ramanujan graphs. But the proofs are a bit complicated. And there's a bunch of work on this.
So David, maybe you're going to talk about it, but in at least some of the CS papers, expander mixing is stated like for any vector V, if you look at the statistical distance between AV and uniform, it's at most like some whatever. Like, is it like it follows right. Once immediately or?
Yeah, I mean we'll so let me do that when I get to random walks. Let me see if I want to. Yeah, well, any questions? The next topic will be random walks on expanders, which I'll start next time, and we'll see applications of that. But close with that. Let me just talk about the notion we're going to use for what does it mean for a random walk to be mixing? we're going to say random walks on expanders converge rapidly. And the notion by converge rapidly, we're going to refer to the variation distance, sometimes called statistical distance. So if you have two probability distributions, say D and D prime on some set X, right, the variation distance, D and D prime, it's statistical in that you take the worst case test set. So you look at all subsets of X, you look at the probability that D places on S and the probability that D prime places on S. And you look at this difference. So this is sort of the statistical test that distinguishes D and D prime the best. And if you think about it, so let's say you have D looks like this, and D prime looks like that. Well, what is your test S going to be? It's going to be either this or this. So you know what the set S is going to be like. It's going to be the set of all nodes where D places more probability than D prime, or vice versa. So using that, it's easy to see that this is 1/2 times the sum S and S of DS minus D prime S. So in other words, it's just half the L1 norm. So the L1 norm is a nice norm for, to make arguments about pseudorandomness, although the L2 norm is easier to deal with mathematically. But so we'll go back and forth and do that next time. But at a high level, expanders are very interesting pseudorandom objects. We've seen connections between the combinatorial definition and the algebraic definition. And next time I'll talk about extractors, and then I'll come back to expanders. So I'll alternate so you start seeing some connections between them.
So the Ramanujan graphs have the basic edge expansion. Is that correct?
No. Oh, so that's a good question, right? So eigenvalues give excellent bounds on expansion, but not the best. So you could show that a random graph a lot of times you're going to want an expansion close bigger than the degree over 2. You want expansion close to the degree for small sets or somewhat small. And
this is D minus 2 square root D minus 1 divided by 1/2, right? Something like that.
Right, so and that's edge expansion.
Yeah.
In fact, so Ramanujan graphs can give even vertex expansion close to degree over 2, but they can't do better than that. Whereas there are some constructions known that beat this eigenvalue bound. And there are other scenarios. Actually, we'll see a scenario, hopefully next class, where we can use extractors to do better than what can be proved using eigenvalues. Yes, it's not going to be for constant degree, but for non-constant degree. Any other questions?
But this is just a well-motivated bar to pass?
Right, yeah, I mean, it's still very nice. Also, the random walks are going to, our analysis of random walks are going to depend on the second eigenvalue. I mean, this is still a terrific result. It's a very important definition. So it's just that they're not equivalent. They're almost equivalent, the combinatorial and algebraic definitions, but they're not. But sometimes you can, David alluded to this too, that sometimes you have can get better bounds in one definition than the other.
So you are only talking about D regular graphs. Is there like a natural definition for expansions?
Yeah, I mean, you could apply this theory. I mean, I haven't looked that much myself at non-regular graphs, but David was saying that you know, with minor modifications, you know, like the expander mixing lemma still holds with minor modifications.
Quantify over big S, and then in the second one you don't. Is it maybe supposed to be like X or something like that?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Thanks.
Like,
yeah.
Like it should be a bound, not an exact equality.
No, it is an exact equality, because we know that the maximum corresponds to the set. So basically, when you sum here, you're going to get one of these, and then when you sum here, you're going to get the other, and that accounts for the factor of two.